I was hoping to bring my dog Luna in today to be a prop here, but I'm not sure she would have been super appreciative or cooperative with that request. So you'll just have to imagine her being present with us, all 60 pounds of white with brown spots of her, panting happily with her tongue out as she gets more attention than she has any idea what to do with it. You can all picture it, right? This happy dog getting her belly rubbed, being asked, who's a good girl? Now toss that image completely out. In ancient Israel, dogs, and cats too for that matter, were much more likely to be considered pests than pets. Oh, they had a purpose, keeping rats and other small nuisances away. But when I was in the Middle East, both in Israel and in Turkey, I got to see the kind of dogs that would have been around in Jesus' time. Small, scrawny, skittish-looking things that whenever we would eat outside, they would crowd around our tables, hoping to snatch a scrap that had dropped on the floor or sneak a bite from the edge of the table when we weren't looking. And they were often rewarded for their efforts with a swift kick, a reminder to stay away, after which they would scatter and then slowly but persistently return. These are the kind of dogs that people in Jesus' time would have thought about. And these are the type of dogs that Jesus would use as an illustration. In our gospel today, Jesus is being pursued by a woman who is shouting at him, "Have mercy on me, son of David." Her daughter, we're told, is being plagued by a demon, and though she is a Canaanite, probably a pagan, she has faith that Jesus, an Israelite, can heal her daughter. With his disciples encouraging him to send her away, Jesus turns to her and says, "My mission, my ministry is only for those who are of the house of Israel." Basically, he says, "You aren't my people. I don't need to help you." Now, whether this is the way the human side of Jesus really felt or whether this is God testing her doesn't matter and isn't the point. Regardless of the intention, the words that the woman heard were the same. "No, I won't help you." And yet she persisted. She pleads again for help. And then Jesus responds with this line: "It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." He's not talking about this loyal, tail-wagging companion, but that scrawny, sniveling pest. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, calls this woman a dog. He tells her that because she's not one of his people, she doesn't deserve to be treated with the same level of dignity and compassion that someone who looked like him would have received. It's a good thing we don't see this happening in our world today, right? It's easy to point and accuse the injustice of it when it happens far away from us across the oceans. It was very clear when racial lines were drawn under apartheid South Africa. That was wrong. It's apparent that when people in India are considered lesser because they're lower down in the caste system, that should change. We lament some cultures in the Middle East who don't allow their women to have the same rights as their men. But it's very different when it happens right under our noses and right down the street from us. Most recently, the world watched as on the night of my birthday, 45 minutes away from where I grew up, a group of American white supremacists gathered in Charlottesville, Virginia. The reason for their gathering again doesn't matter and isn't the point. The point is that in an area of the country that I am intimately familiar with, a group of people were allowed to gather to declare themselves superior to another group of people because of one insignificant aspect of their physical selves, the color of their skin. And their hatred would lead to violence and death. So how do we hear Jesus in this? It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. Sounds like it would fit right in with the rhetoric used by the supremacists in Charlottesville. Fortunately, our gospel story hasn't ended yet, and we don't have the answer yet to what Jesus would do and say. Now, after Jesus' dog comment, if it had been me in that woman's shoes, I probably would have turned away in anger or in sadness. So fortunately, it wasn't me then, because again, she persisted. Yes, Lord, she answers and even affirms his statement. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. She appeals to him and says, even if you can't see me on the same level as you, even if we aren't the same, we are still fed from the same place. We still share some common humanity. We still need the same things. And at this point, whether through a change of mind or a final acknowledgement of her true faith, Jesus' heart is softened. He commends this woman for her faith and persistence, and her daughter is instantly healed. I believe this speaks volumes about the nature of our God. You'll have to ask me at a later date whether I believe this woman truly changed the mind of God or simply proved to Christ that she had faith. But again, that's not the point. What God in Jesus showed to this woman and to his disciples and to us is that God's mercy is far more expansive than anyone at that time could believe. Through this story, we see that in Jesus' ministry, God's mercy continued to expand wider and wider. And through our lives, as we continue to learn more about our God, we as followers in Christ are called to follow Jesus' example and exhibit wider and wider love and mercy. As God's mercy was shown from this moment forward to be more expansive and inclusive than it was thought to be before, so our great nation has changed as well. When the United States were first formed, though liberty and justice were promised to all, it was in actuality only a free country for property-owning white men. But as we've grown as a country, the freedom has expanded far beyond that narrow understanding. That regardless of gender, regardless of race, regardless of anything about who you are promised the same freedoms and mercy as those for whom the country was originally intended. As God's kingdom has no place for hatred, bigotry, or violence, so our country should have no place for hatred, bigotry, or violence. This is not a political issue. This is an identity issue. For us to live most fully into our lives as Christian people, we must show God's mercy to those who are the most vulnerable. We should learn so that we don't repeat the hateful or simply ignorant mistakes that have been made before. We should condemn those like the supremacists who place themselves above others because of an aspect of who they are. The only person who's ever had the right to place himself above others was Jesus, God in human form. By every right, Jesus, because of who he was, could have proclaimed himself superior to us and had us reduced to the lowest low. But we know that he didn't. And in fact, he went lower than even us so that we could be raised up like him. And he in turn calls us to do the same for others who may in society's eyes be lower than us. All of this from a man who today we heard call a woman a dog. This is not an easy or a comfortable story. This is often not an easy or comfortable calling. This is many times not an easy or comfortable example to follow. But I invite you to walk with me as we move forward from today and explore for us what following Christ's example in this story can look like. Amen.